Greetings and welcome to my channel. I am Paul Kiritsis and today I'm going to be talking to you a little bit about my recent book, Tales of a Spiritual Son. It's really hard to put into words the degree to which my ancestral lands and their histories have shaped me. I am not only a byproduct of, but a living embodiment of the enduring Hellenistic culture. Even now, at the age of 43, I feel the exact same awe and reverence for it as I did when I first heard passages of the Iliad and the Odyssey recited in Katharevousa Greek. Katharevousa Greek is an archaic and very formal variant of Greek, by my Greek teachers in junior high school. Where does one start with an emotionally loaded topic such as this? Oh, the beginning, one might say. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with the imagination, and the Word was the imagination. So let's go ahead and start with myth, which is what the present book honours. Myth is one discrete and powerful form of narrative. The function of myth has been a topic of contentious and polemical debate. Are these proto-scientific accounts of historical phenomena? Are they quasi-scientific attempts to understand psychological processes and spiritual truths? Are they distorted memories of the past? Are they transmitters of magico-religious ceremonies? Did they emerge, in part, as a mechanism of neural integration and coordination between the dominant and non-dominant hemispheres of the brain? All we can offer are educated guesses, but in truth, we don't really know. What we do know is that they ground our lived experience in a linear sequential framework. They serve as blueprints for emotional regulation, problem-solving, behavior, and identity, and they provide frameworks for goal attainment and movement to self-definition. They address questions like, who am I? Who are we? How did I come to be? What is this world? How did the world come to be? Who created the world? And what are the moral, social codes of conduct that govern our behavior and society as a whole? What are the consequences of lawmaking and lawbreaking? In this capacity, they are the most valuable, exquisite things we will ever know. They are worth all their weight in gold. Through myths, we create and we recreate, and we construct, deconstruct, and reconstruct ourselves personally and collectively, generationally and intergenerationally. Myths, as we know, are temporally and culturally bound. And despite so, they speak to us and play with our heartstrings in an impartial and indiscriminate manner. They are timeless and very relatable, and if not relatable, they can be made relatable. The antediluvian allegory of Atlantis, for instance, cleverly implies that the destruction of the old precedes generation of the new. In a time before this, King Minos of Crete imprisoned the Minotaur, the theriomorphic son of Queen Pasiphae, in a subterranean labyrinth. We too imprison our instinctual drives, our sadomasochistic and destructive impulses, within a socially mediated pattern that can restrict self-definition and self-expression. Jason, the legendary Greek hero, once embarked on a dangerous quest to Colchis to capture a priceless treasure known as the Golden Fleece. Is this not a figurative expression of the intrinsic rewards that come from risk-taking behavior and having the chutzpah to venture beyond one's own comfort zone or map territory? I am sure you have heard the axiom, you can never discover new oceans unless you have the courage to lose sight of the shore. The myth of Jason echoes that. The Egyptian Isis is inexorable in her plight to gather the scattered parts of her dismembered brother-husband, Osiris. Like Isis, life equips us with ample opportunities to become whole again by gathering back dismembered parts of ourselves that were not mirrored, validated, or celebrated. Not all our stories are benign or noble, though. Like the vengeful sorceress Circe, we can direct the full brunt of our jealousy at a lover when we are no longer the preferred object of their desirousness. King Midas underscores the idea that some people are harbingers of serendipity. However, what gold can come good of wishing if it is barren of common sense? We can be furtive and disingenuous in pursuit of our selfish agendas. Disguised as a femme fatale, Isis confronts her brother Seth on an island and tells him that a stranger entered her life after the death of her husband, intent on stealing domestic possessions and banishing her young son from the household. Without thinking, Seth reproaches the foreigner for the same injustice which he was attempting to commit against little Horace, and in doing so, unwittingly confesses his own depravity. Knowledge, my friends, is power, and we are perpetually conflicted as to whether we should use it for personal gain or altruistic ventures beneficial to society as a whole. A long time ago, the goddess Isis blackmailed the sun god Ra by poisoning him with the serpent made from his own spittle, and then agreeing to heal him on condition that he reveal his secret name to her. These are the dark, less than honorable shadows pervading the human spirit. One of the questions I frequently get asked is, what inspires you or has inspired you? I am an Australian of Greek ancestry, and my earliest contact and engagement with narrative came in the form of classical mythology. The Odyssey, the Iliad, tales of Pegasus and Medusa from Hesiod's Theogony. I'll tell you a little bit about my family. My family's played a huge role in my upbringing and, you know, as a source of inspiration. Both my parents left Macedonia, Greece for greener pastures in Australia in 1970 and 1978, bringing with them a pastoral Hellenistic lifestyle rife with metaphysical, folkloristic, and mythological ideas. My mother's family is descended from the mystical firewalkers of pagan Thrace, and my maternal grandmother was an active participant in the annual festivities connected to the modern-day cult until fairly recently. My father's family, on the other hand, is descended of the passionate, ebullient Greeks of Asia Minor, specifically Constantinople, which is modern-day Istanbul. Even though my parents were not religious in a conventional sense, the culture-laden household emanated these archetypal narratives, legends, and folk tales by the tenfold. Surrounded by such cultural abundance, my life was bound to be an exploding supernova right from the very beginning. My mother and paternal grandmother would narrate popular Greek tragedies, myths, and folk tales from imported books, and I would spontaneously fixate upon the pictures and point towards the protagonists. As early as 5, I knew all about the nymphs, the vampires, the Christmas goblins, which in Greek are called kalikanzari, and the magical rituals aimed at depotentiating their demonic and emasculating powers. Superstition was tantamount to normalcy in my household, and it was never scoffed at nor questioned. My mother, and my paternal grandmother in particular, were great storytellers, so immersion in the fantastical realms of Greek mythology came pretty early for me. In hindsight, what really fascinated me about the myths at the time was the fact that these were actual stories that came embedded with morals and philosophical as well as spiritual truths. To give an example is Psyche and Cupid, a love story, or the plight of one's soul to find true love. Is Pygmalion and Galatea about prejudice subjugated by love, or is it about a misogynist punished by the gods for his sin? Or is it about fetishes and necrophilia? The bubbly magic of it all is that it can be either of these, or neither, or both. That is the magic of classical mythology. The stories can be literal or allegorical in nature. I was exposed to innumerable Greek poems and stories in my youth, including the romance Erotokritos, which translates to He Who Is Judged by Love. This was a Greek Renaissance poem consisting of about 10,012 15-syllable rhymed verses. This one would go on to become my absolute favourite. It was first composed in the early 17th century by Vikentios Kornaros in the Cretan dialect of the Greek language. Though revolving around the love between Erotokritos and Aretusa, Aretusa means the fairest woman or the most virtuous, it is very redolent of the recorded love between the hero Odysseus, the king of Ithaca, and Penelope. This poem is a mandinatha, a rhyming dialogue comprised of rhyming couplets and accompanied by wistful music, usually an instrument like the Cretan lira. Mandinathas are very popular on, you guessed it, Crete. A Portuguese analog of this type of music is fado, which expresses the powerful sentiment Sodachi. And these are the lyrics to Arethusa's lamentation. Fate, do your worst. Do what you wish of me. With nothing left, why should I seek to flee? You are my all in all, asleep, awake. Home, honors, all, I ceded for your sake. You took the place of mother and of sire. Protokritos, you were my sole desire. I sleep on straw, of sackcloth is my dress. Yet I reck not the torments that oppress. For you I languish in this prison cell, and here for 5 long years I dwelt and dwell. Protokritos, you died far, far away. What in this world is left for me today? Had I been with you in that dread blade, and you had called on me to give you aid, would that I had been with you on that day, then hand in hand we could have gone death's way. And though on earth we two were never wed, in Hades we would find our marriage bed. And if you've ever wondered what the poem sounds like when it's sung, here is a rendition. So I wanted to talk to you a little bit more about influences, and there are two major influences which led to the birth of Tales of a Spiritual Son. During my formative years, I attended Greek Orthodox Church sporadically and became acquainted with the great patriarchal father ruling the supernal heavens above, which we all loosely refer to as God. The universal craftsman is usually painted onto the church's dome or conch and stares down at his subjects in an authoritative manner. Below him in the apse are the frescoed saints and evangelists. Often, the Virgin Mary is strategically placed between heaven and earth as the principal mediator and merciful intercessor between the divine and earthly dimensions of existence. In the Greek Orthodox tradition, Mary can only claim the honor of hyperdulia, hyperdulia, or superior veneration. Even though Christianity and the early church fathers demoted her from her position as the seed and source of all life, I connected with her instantly. I recognized her as the numinous archetypal mother, my spiritual mother. It was she to whom I knelt and prayed night after night when I came down with a malady of unknown origin in my early teens. It was she who I remembered when I wrote Shades of Aphrodite, In Search of the Golden Apple, and Tales of a Spiritual Son between the years of 2007 and 2012. The other influence is much more obvious. Being a voracious reader in general, I happened to stumble upon some very fascinating contemporary retellings of classical myths. I read Margaret Atwood's The Penelopiad and Jeanette Winterson's Atlas, The Myth of Atlas and Hercules. Sometime in 2009 or 2010, and thought to myself, well, you know the Greek myths so well, why don't you reinterpret some of the Greek myths yourself? That is how the concept for this short story collection was born. Naturally, I was not content with just a retelling. I wanted to rework, remold, rebirth, and breathe new life into these myths. These had to be contemporary stories with literal or symbolic allusions to their classical counterparts. But they also had to reflect modern-day concerns and societal issues. For example, the Proteus short story works through sci-fi and thriller genre to illuminate the dangers and pitfalls of human genetic engineering and pioneering artificial intelligence systems that may one day overwhelm us. The AI phenomenon definitely comes to mind here. Entrapment, with its literal allusion to the Trojan horse, and the constant switching between two different character perspectives, revolves around issues of radicalization and extremism, religious zealotry, indoctrination, and cults. Some other ones, like Mind Games, for instance. Mind Games is about a Ouija board, and Nymphomania, which is basically the story of a man who is convinced that his wife is a nymph, exploit the realities of dreaming and waking cognition and the porous boundary between the two. So, what is actually real? Some stories remain faithful to the original plots and others veer very far from their original plot lines. Some myths are very recognizable while others are more abstruse and quite obscure and esoteric. So, another question I get asked a lot is, where did you get the idea for the title? Well, spiritual sun is a reference to a heart center. As we all know, the physical sun is the center of the solar system. A sun can be construed as either a child or an astral body. Phonetically, the title reveals my love of puns, metaphors, allegories, and multiple meanings. Why spiritual sun? Well, I'm a student of spirituality and esotericism, and have been for a long time. And I'm immensely concerned with how the nomothetic sciences and empiricism can reconcile with esoteric spirituality and beliefs that currently lie outside the purview of the orthodox scientific disciplines. In fact, many of these stories mirror some of these concerns, and the theme reverberates in many of my other works as well. I've written a book on precognitive dreams or dreams of the future, which are a form of extrasensory perception and the source of creativity. So it runs through that one as well as my other book, The Creative Advantages of Schizophrenia. So there's a unifying theme across all of these. So the Forward Clarion Review had this to say about Tales of a Spiritual Sun. Greek myths are revitalized via the modern editions of psychology and science in the evolving short story collection, Tales of a Spiritual Sun. So this happens to be a very accurate appraisal. I have used Greek myths as a vehicle to convey modern day and real world concerns. And many of these concerns are intimately entwined with the philosophies and theories of modern psychology and biology. Attempting to make sense out of conflicting information and worldviews, and working through one's own fears, whether these fears are real or imagined, so that you can come to a place of inner peace, is for all intents and purposes a spiritual affair, so hence spiritual sun. There are 13 retellings in this short story collection. There is a preface followed by a creation myth set in Knossos in Crete, and this is entitled To Propitiate the Earth, which is essentially about birth, death, and regeneration, the ending of one world and the beginning of another. This is followed by stories about the Fates and King Midas, and psychological interpretations of love stories like Eurydice and Orpheus, Pygmalion and Galatea, Eros and Psyche, and last but not least, Narcissus and Echo. This is followed by modern day encounters with villains like the Minotaur and the Theban Sphinx and the Gorgon's Theno and the shape-shifting water deity Proteus. The final two stories are very, very dramatic and allude to the Trojan horse and to Pandora's box. Well, I hope you enjoyed that short presentation. If you want to know more, you could always buy and read the book and get back to me and let me know what you think. So it is available via all online bookstores, including Amazon and Barnes & Noble. And you can also acquire it through Olympia Publishers as well. which is the publisher of the book. Thank you very much, and I will see you next time.